Good afternoon, students. Here we start with the gross anatomy of the inguinal canal. Theory portion, how you will describe the inguinal canal. So, in this inguinal canal, first will be the definition. In the definition of the inguinal canal, it is a narrow musculo-aponeurotic canal which is 4 cm in length, and the direction of the canal will be downwards, forwards and medially. So, therefore, the direction of the canal will be downwards, forwards, medially. The length of the canal will be 4 centimeters, and it is a narrow musculo-aponeurotic canal, 4 centimeters in length, directed downwards, forwards, medially, and it is located above the medial half of inguinal ligament. So, if you draw the inguinal ligament, supposing if you draw the inguinal ligament, if this is the inguinal ligament over here, then on the medial half of inguinal ligament, just above the medial half of inguinal ligament, where my hand is there, will be the presence of inguinal canal over here. Now we come to, since definition is there, now total length 4 cm, the direction downwards, forwards, medially. Now we come to the contents straight away. In the contents, please note down, there will be passage of spermatic cord in males and round ligament of uterus in females. So, spermatic cord will pass and round ligament of uterus will pass. Here I will just mention the contents on this side, and spermatic cord and round ligament of uterus in females. And also, ilioinguinal nerve. Now, this ilioinguinal nerve will pierce the internal oblique muscle 2.5 cm below the level of anterior superior iliac spine. So, below and medial to anterior superior iliac spine 2.5 cm, the ilioinguinal nerve will pierce and enter the inguinal canal. So, there are two basically contents, there are two contents of the inguinal canal. Number one, in males, spermatic cord and ilioinguinal nerve, and in females, round ligament of uterus and ilioinguinal nerve. Now, what is the extent? We come to extent. The extent will be from the deep inguinal ring to superficial inguinal ring. Now, if I draw, let me draw with white color. Deep inguinal ring, if I show this deep inguinal ring, and over here, if I want to show here, superficial inguinal ring. So, here I will name this as deep inguinal ring, and here superficial inguinal ring. So, the extent of inguinal canal will be between deep and superficial inguinal ring. Now, we come to, after the extent and contents, we come to boundaries. This is very important. In theory question, you have to understand, write the boundaries. Anterior wall, posterior wall, superior, inferior boundary. Very interesting. Let us try and understand anterior wall. What are the anterior boundaries? So, in the boundaries, if I mention here the next point, just the boundaries, and in the boundaries, anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, please come on this side. Now, we will draw. We'll remember it, memorize it, the boundaries by drawing. So, let us memorize all these boundaries by drawing. Anterior wall is formed by number one, skin, number two, superficial fascia, number three, external oblique aponeurosis. So, I want to represent the external oblique aponeurosis in this form. So, if I draw this as external oblique aponeurosis, let me draw this. This is external oblique aponeurosis, and here I will mention this as external oblique aponeurosis. So, anterior wall of the inguinal canal is formed by number one, skin, number two, superficial fascia, number three, external oblique aponeurosis, and number four, very important. Here, lateral one third, it is strengthened by, or there will be presence of anteriorly, the fleshy fibers of internal oblique muscle. So, internal oblique muscle, which we will draw, and that will be on the lateral one third. Anterior wall, lateral one third, it will be by internal oblique fleshy fibers. So, therefore, here we will mention this as the internal oblique muscle, the fleshy fibers of internal oblique in the lateral one third. So anterior wall is complete. The anterior wall of inguinal canal, which is 4 cm directed downwards, forwards, medially extending between deep inguinal ring and superficial inguinal ring, which is present above the medial half of inguinal ligament. The anterior wall is formed by skin, superficial fascia, external oblique aponeurosis, and lateral one third by internal oblique muscle. These four structures form the anterior wall. Very interesting. Now posterior wall. Posterior wall of inguinal canal, once again we'll draw. Posterior wall of inguinal canal is formed by fascia transversalis. So fascia transversalis will form the posterior wall. So let me mark this as, here I will mark these as fascia transversalis. These are the vertical lines which I am showing it as fascia transversalis. And we are going to mark here fascia transversalis. Entire posterior wall of inguinal canal, fascia transversalis. Plus posterior wall on the medial half of inguinal canal, medial half of inguinal canal, this much posterior wall, it will be having the presence of conjoint tendon, and we understood conjoint tendon in the previous segments. Conjoint tendon or fox inguinalis, it is the lowest aponeurotic fibers of internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. So this conjoint tendon will form posterior wall of inguinal canal in the medial half. So let us draw the conjoint tendon, and that conjoint tendon, let us represent it with the help of blue color here. This will form the conjoint tendon posterior wall, and it is present in medial half of inguinal ligament, medial half of inguinal ligament, posterior wall. So inguinal canal, posterior wall on the medial half by conjoint tendon, and let us mark this as conjoint tendon, or it is called fox inguinalis. So this is structure number 2, posterior wall. Structure number 1, posterior wall, is fascia transversalis of the inguinal canal, and structure number 2, posterior wall of inguinal canal, medial half, is conjoint tendon. And now structure number 3. So if I give the numbers here, number 1, posterior wall, fascia transversalis, number 2, conjoint tendon, posterior wall, medial half, and now number 3, posterior wall of inguinal canal, medial one third. Now this medial one third is reflected part of inguinal ligament, and so here we go with, if I show this as reflected part of inguinal ligament, and here we can mark this as number 3, reflected part of inguinal ligament. This will be present in the posterior wall of inguinal canal in the medial one third, medial one fourth only, not one third but one fourth only. So once again I repeat, posterior wall of inguinal canal is completely formed by fascia transversalis, number 1. Number 2, it is formed by conjoint tendon or fox inguinalis in the medial half of the posterior wall of inguinal canal. And number 3, medial one fourth of the posterior wall, it is formed by reflected part of inguinal ligament. These are the 3 structures which form the posterior wall of inguinal canal. Now, since we have completed anterior wall, posterior wall, now the roof. The roof of this inguinal canal will be formed by the fibers of internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. So simply in the roof, we can show vertical arrows. Here we can show the vertical arrows, and these vertical arrows, we are going to name them as internal oblique plus transversus abdominis muscle. So together these vertical arrows, the roof portion, they are formed by internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. So the roof of inguinal canal is formed by internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. Now we come to the floor. Remember, the floor is formed by the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament. So the floor is formed by the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament, and here we shall mark here as the floor, which is formed by the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament, and medially there will be presence of lacunar ligament also. So here medially there will be presence of this lacunar ligament in the floor also. So here we can mark this as lacunar ligament. So in the floor there will be two structures, the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament and medially lacunar ligament. Here we finish the four boundaries of the inguinal canal. Number one, once again I repeat, anterior wall formed by skiing superficial fascia and the external oblique aponeurosis, including in the lateral one-third by fibers of internal oblique. Anterior wall is complete. Posterior wall is formed entirely by fascia transversalis. And number two, by the fibers of conjoint tendon in the medial half. And number three, medial one-fourth by reflected part of inguinal ligament, posterior wall. Then we come to the roof. The roof is formed only by the fibers of internal oblique and transverse abdominis muscle. And then we come to the floor of inguinal canal. The floor of inguinal canal is formed by the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament and medially by lacunar ligament. Very easy, very simple to understand, very interesting. Anterior wall, posterior wall, the roof and the floor of inguinal canal. Many times it is asked in MCQs, one more question answer. Now we go further. Inlet and outlet of inguinal canal. So this entire portion here, which I have drawn, if I draw like this, this entire portion is our inguinal canal. Now inlet, this is the inlet, deep inguinal ring. Outlet, this will be the outlet, as here, superficial inguinal ring. Inlet, outlet, and we know the contents of the inguinal canal, we have already discussed. So in the inlet of inguinal canal, now after the boundaries is the inlet and then the outlet. This is also very important, one mark question answer MCQ. The inlet is formed by oval opening in fascia transversalis. There is an oval opening in fascia transversalis 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. Please note down. So 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. What is mid inguinal point? Mid inguinal point is midpoint between anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis. Midpoint between anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis is called mid inguinal point. So around 1.25 cm above mid inguinal point is an oval opening in fascia transversalis, which is known as deep inguinal ring. So here please mention this as deep inguinal ring, oval opening in fascia transversalis, deep inguinal ring, this structure. This will serve as the inlet. And one more question answer, one more point. From the deep inguinal ring, it will send fibers, or there will be an extension covering the spermatic cord and testes. And that extension which covers the spermatic cord and testes from deep inguinal ring is known as internal spermatic fascia. Please note down. So from this, there will be an extension known as internal spermatic fascia. So extension of deep inguinal ring will be internal spermatic fascia. This is another important point. And what is deep inguinal ring? Oval opening within fascia transversalis. Location 1.25 cm above the mid inguinal point. We come to outlet here. This is the outlet. Very interesting. Superficial inguinal ring. What is it basically? The outlet is formed by superficial inguinal ring, which is a triangular opening in external oblique aponeurosis. This is a triangular opening in external oblique aponeurosis. Please note down. Deep inguinal ring is an oval opening in the fascia transversalis. Superficial inguinal ring is a triangular opening in external oblique aponeurosis. So this triangular opening is present. It is having certain boundaries which you need to understand. It is the base of this will be present on the pubic crest. So there will be location of pubic crest over here, base. Base of superficial inguinal ring, pubic crest. And here I will mention this as pubic crest. And here superficial inguinal ring. Then it is bounded by, as you can see, it is bounded by two crusts. I hope this is visible. Yep. It is bounded by two crusts. And these two crusts will be, now here, this crust, medial crust. And this is the lateral. Now medial crust is attached to symphysis pubis. Where my finger is there, it will be attached to symphysis pubis. Medial crust. Lateral crust or inferior crust. Lateral is called inferior crust, is attached to here, pubic tubercle. So this one will be pubic tubercle. Once again, I'll repeat, the medial crust is also known as superior crust. So here I can mention this as superior crust of superficial inguinal ring. Superficial inguinal ring will have a base, which is on the pubic crest. It will have medially superior crust, which is attached to symphysis pubis, and it will have laterally this, which is known as inferior crust. So laterally here, not down, inferior crust, which is attached on the pubic tubercle. Please note down. Superiorly, both the crura, that is the superior crust and inferior crust, they will merge together superiorly. So it will form a triangular outlet in external oblique aponeurosis, which is called superficial inguinal ring. Very clear, very simple. This is bounded, superficial inguinal ring is bounded medially by the superior crust. It is bounded laterally by the inferior crust. Now, after understanding the superficial inguinal ring, the outlet, we have to understand the defensive mechanism of inguinal canal. This entire is inguinal canal, entire. So after this, writing the boundaries, noting the boundaries and the inlet and outlet in the form of deep inguinal ring and superficial inguinal ring, we have to mention a few points in defensive mechanism of inguinal canal. Defensive mechanism of inguinal canal based is based upon several points. Particularly, it is a natural defensive mechanism to prevent the inguinal hernia in day-to-day activities. This entire method is called defensive mechanism of inguinal canal, and the points are, number one, very interesting points. The first point in defensive mechanism will be, first I will mention the points. If I write here, defensive mechanism of inguinal canal, point number one. Let me mention point number one. Simply I have mentioned here point number one. We come to this diagram once again. The entire inguinal canal is placed in oblique direction, and the level of superficial inguinal ring and deep inguinal ring will be at different places, different levels. So in cases of increased intra-abdominal pressure, when the abdominal pressure increases in day-to-day activities, what will happen? The posterior wall will be pushed forwards, downwards, and will close with the anterior wall in such a way that it will obliterate this passage. It will obliterate the inguinal canal. In cases of increased intra-abdominal pressure, remember, posterior wall of inguinal canal will come forwards, push forwards, downwards, and will close with the anterior wall. And this mechanism, this particular mechanism, when the posterior wall comes downwards, forwards, and it will close with the anterior wall, thus it will narrow down or almost obliterate the entire inguinal canal. This mechanism is known as flap valve mechanism. So the first point here, I will mention this as flap valve mechanism. This is the first point of defensive mechanism of inguinal canal, flap valve mechanism. We understood that. Now second point, let me first name the second point. The second point after flap valve mechanism, the second point I will mention it as ball valve mechanism. Ball valve mechanism. Once again, we come on this side here. Superficial inguinal ring, it will allow the passage of the spermatic cord and the fascia covering spermatic cord. Now, remember, during cases of increased intra-abdominal pressure, what happens will be in males, the cremaster muscle will undergo contraction. There will be extreme amount of contraction of cremaster muscle, as a result of which it will pull the testes above towards the superficial inguinal ring. The cremaster muscle in males will contract in such a way that testes is pulled forwards, upwards towards the superficial inguinal ring. Thus, it will block like a plug. This superficial inguinal ring will be blocked like a plug. In which cases, in cases of increased intra-abdominal pressure, in normal day-to-day activities, in cases of extreme amount of increased intra-abdominal pressure in cases of males, natural mechanism is the cremaster muscle will contract, which will pull the testes above towards the superficial inguinal ring, which will block like a plug, and therefore this mechanism of blockage is known as ball valve mechanism, because the spermatic cord and the testes, they are pulled towards the superficial inguinal ring, which will block like a plug. And so it is called ball valve mechanism by Cremaster muscle. By which muscle? Cremaster muscle. This is the second method of defense mechanism of inguinal canal. Now the third method. Here I will write here. Third point. The third point will be shutter mechanism. So let us write down the shutter mechanism. Two muscles will come into play here. If you visualize this diagram, broadly if you visualize the white arrows which I had drawn, the roof portion. Roof is formed by these white arrows. The roof of the inguinal canal is formed by internal oblique and transverse abdominis muscle. So the fibers of internal oblique and transverse abdominis muscle which form the roof. What will happen in cases of increased intra-abdominal pressure? Once again, these fibers will contract and they will come from the roof. The roof will be approximated with the floor. The fibers will contract in such a way that the roof will be approximated with the floor, and thus this entire inguinal canal will be obliterated. This mechanism, this defensive mechanism of inguinal canal is known as shutter mechanism, by which the roof portion of internal oblique and transverse abdominis muscle will contract and will oppose with the floor, and thus the entire inguinal canal is obliterated. This is the third point, that is shutter mechanism. Now we come to the fourth point. Please come on this side. First, second, third. The first is flap valve mechanism, which we understood. Second is ball valve mechanism. Third is the shutter mechanism. And fourth. Now in the fourth, please remember, the entire inguinal canal is oblique in direction. The entire inguinal canal is obliquely placed. We know that. So what will happen will be, in this inguinal canal, there will be, in cases of increased abdominal pressure, contraction of abdominal muscles. And then the abdominal muscles will contract. What will happen? The deep inguinal ring will be shifted upwards and laterally, in such a way that the entire oblique inguinal passage will be converted into a narrow canal. And in this way, it is one of the defense mechanisms of inguinal canal, by contraction of abdominal muscles. So the entire obliquely placed inguinal canal will be converted into a narrow passage because of the shifting of deep inguinal ring upwards and laterally. When does this occur? When the abdominal muscles will contract. This is the fourth point of defense mechanism of inguinal canal. The fifth point of defense mechanism of inguinal canal, in the fifth point, the entire stretch of inguinal canal, if I write from deep inguinal ring till superficial inguinal ring. So here, this is the fifth point, from deep to superficial inguinal ring. Please come on this side now, this diagram, be focused. The entire inguinal canal is from deep to superficial inguinal ring, and now the deep inguinal ring is positioned in such a way that it is strengthened naturally anteriorly by fibers of internal oblique. We know that anterior wall of inguinal canal in the lateral one third is formed by fibers of internal oblique. So deep inguinal ring is protected, rather it is strengthened anteriorly by internal oblique fibers, fleshy fibers of internal oblique. Superficial inguinal ring is strengthened posteriorly by conjoint tendon and reflected part of inguinal ligament. Conjoint tendon and reflected part of inguinal ligament will strengthen superficial inguinal ring posteriorly. In this way, both deep and superficial inguinal rings are strengthened by respectively internal oblique fibers and conjoint tendon and reflected part of inguinal ligament. This is the fifth point which will be for the defense mechanism, this fifth point for the defense mechanism of inguinal canal. Please note down this fifth point. So in this way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are the five different points which we can explain in the defensive mechanism of inguinal canal. Here we end our entire topic of inguinal canal. Thank you very much.